scepter sways. From bowl to bowl that wars may cease, and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end, and round his peers in feet, their flowers of paradise extend, their fragrance ever sweet.
O God, for thy spirit of life, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our nights. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us.
Good morning, friends and family. Welcome to Highland. Thank you for being here today. We're going to go ahead and get started. Our focus for the month of September has been on the North Carolina Missions Offering. So this morning we're going to watch a video that highlights that work, specifically in the town of Shelby.
They always say you don't know what you got till it's gone. Well, I know what that saying means. A lot of history down here, and this is a family farm. My dad was born and raised here, and this was my love all my life. I saw on TV people would be in hurricanes or something like that and have their home destroyed, but I never thought it'd happen to me. I looked back at my home as we were driving away, and I thought, I don't have a home. You know, it's gone. You can't ever imagine what happens when one minute you have a home and everything, and the next minute, you know, it's about gone. And you don't have power and don't have running water. It's been almost about 6 months, and I slept in my truck for over 3 months. I mean, every night before they started working, but I mean, you couldn't even walk through. David and his crew comes over every morning. They work like Trojans to clean my house up. It's just overwhelming. They were all, in my eyes, angels, and I don't really think I deserve this. I appreciate it, but all these people that helped me, I don't even know some of their names. They come in here and smile and you know, help me out and don't ask for a thing in return. It's gonna be so nice to have it again, a home. You know, I keep telling people, the Lord's going to make my place a home again.
Thank you, all of you who have donated that offering this month. And thank you also to the mission team who went to Shelby. At this time, we have Joe Garso. He's outside. He will be bringing us our announcements this morning. So in just a second, you're going to hear from Joe.
That better? All right, let me start again. Good morning. Welcome to Highland Baptist Church. I have several announcements, one of which is not on the bulletin. First up, the North Carolina Missions Offering. Building on the video, The North Carolina Mission Offering is a special offering received during the month of September that supports the ministries of Baptists on Mission, church planting, mission camps, associational projects, and mobilization ministry projects. The NCMO is your opportunity to impact lostness as God accomplishes many wonderful things through these various ministries. Our goal is $4,000. We've received just under half of that to date as of this printing. Second up, if you have any outstanding receipts from August, please get those turned in, approved to Max Miller as soon as possible so he can close out the fiscal year 21. There's a prayer walk scheduled for tomorrow at 6:30 p.m. in consideration of the recommendations of the congregation to begin a concerted prayer effort. The transition team invites everyone to join them in a prayer walk at the church. And finally, if you're not receiving the email update, you can either call the church office or email Terry at the email in the bulletin to start get on the list for the email updates. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Let's stand and sing "To God Be the Glory."
To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth.
Let's open this morning with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you that in your wisdom you set at naught all man's self-proclaimed wisdom and man's self-confident merit by sending the Lord Jesus to die on the cross and rise again the third day, proclaiming faith in him to be the way of salvation. Keep us looking to Jesus, living humbly before you all the days of our lives. To your praise and glory, God, thank you for the wisdom and power of the cross, which has saved us by grace through faith in Christ, and will make us into likeness of the Lord Jesus day by day. Keep us low at the cross, and help us to keep our priorities focused on you, knowing that the cross is a stumbling block to some and foolishness to others. This we ask in your name and thank you for your grace. Amen. Let's stand and sing, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine."
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a glory!
This is my story, this this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, pray from above,
echoes of mercy,
whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, always at rest, I am my Savior and happy and blessed. Watching Him, waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, His solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled and striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, His gift of love and righteousness, sworn by the ones He came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Every sin on Him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground His body laid. Light of the world, by darkness slain, bursting forth in glorious day. From the grave He rose again, and as He stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, I am His and He is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. In life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first breath to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from His hand. Turns and calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
calls me home. Here in the brow of Christ I'll stand.
Amen. You all may be seated. We're going to continue to worship this morning. This is Be Still and Know That I Am God. Joe Arso is again coming. He will be reading the scripture for us for today, as well as giving the offertory prayer.
I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 through 31. Please follow along. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. And because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption, so that, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. Let us pray. We come to you today thankful for the many blessings you brought forth in our lives. And we ask that you allow us to just give back a small portion, that we do so joyfully, because God loves a cheerful giver. Lord, may these blessings and tithes and offerings be to serve you throughout your kingdom, beginning here at 8524 Crowder Road and spreading out to wherever we take you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Joe. And thank you all who are outside. Thank you for coming and joining us today. Thank you who are online watching us. I got to keep remembering that everybody's not returning, and we are reaching people around the world, very possibly. I know my brother in Texas watches almost every week, not live, but usually recorded, sometimes live. So it's kind of cool to know that he's picking us up later, along with quite a few others. It's good to see you this morning. Got a question. Actually, I try to open most Sunday mornings with a question. Don't know if you figured that out, but there are a couple of really interesting books that go right along with the title of this sermon today, God's Folly or Man's. Have you heard of the book called The Insanity of God by Nip Ripken? Anybody heard that book? Missionaries and my wife, and a couple of more. Well, I won't even ask the next one, Insanity of Obedience. Did you get to read that one? No, haven't. Oh, I got you on that one. Listen, you know, does God and folly, or God's folly, actually go in the same sentence? It's almost an oxymoron, isn't it? You know, oxymoron is you're saying one thing and kind of mean really the opposite. This don't go together, but to say God's folly seems to fit that bill, even though I don't even like saying that. Or like the title of this book, God is Insane. Or the insanity of God, and the insanity of actually obeying God to the point where it will cost your life. Certainly imprisonment, suffering, persecution. I remember a man that I met with a number of times in Indonesia on the island of Sumatra, and his name was Pak Marsitu. And Pak Marsitu had traveled with one of my friends through the villages where he went, and the man was teaching from the Gospel of John very regularly, which talks a lot about Jesus very clearly. And Pak Marsitu came and he sat in on my class on Monday morning after he'd been with my friend all weekend, and I was talking about the Trinity. Well, the Trinity is one of the most difficult things for a Muslim to understand. Little wonder it's pretty hard for me to understand too. I don't know about you. But he's told me he provided lunch that day, tripe. Anybody know what tripe is? Stomach. First time I'd ever had it, and I ate it with joy. Mr. Marsitu looked at me over lunch and said, I wish I could leave, but I would have to leave everything, my wife, my family, my job, and flee for my life. What do you say to somebody like that? But the Bible is full of it. These books are full of examples of people who were willing to obey God at the cost of persecution, physical suffering, imprisonment, and even death. The author himself begins the book by talking about how he and his family were serving in Africa and how they got malaria quite a few times. And it was recommended that maybe you need to go somewhere else. You can take some prophylaxis medications, but it's imperfect. Eventually, one of their sons got sick. I can't remember if it was from malaria or not, but he got sick and died on the mission field. Now, I don't know about you, but I tend to like to think that God watches over us and takes care of us, especially those of us who go halfway around the world and serve in Africa or Indonesia or other places in the world. What about you? Don't you tend to like to think at least that God watches over us and takes care of us and we don't have to worry about any suffering? Yes. But the reality of it is, not only from those books, but from the main book, God uses suffering, persecution, even death of his saints to help the faith of his other saints and to grow the church among those who are yet to believe. As difficult as it is to comprehend, that's exactly what God does. This man, Nick Ripken, watched his child die while they were serving in Africa. They came back to heal, and God seemed to speak to Nick Ripken to go study how the suffering believers helps grow their faith as well as the church. It was said in that book that, for example, in China, church leaders who have not yet gone to prison are looked on a little bit skeptically. Not sure they're going to make it because they hadn't had to suffer yet. They hadn't had to go to prison yet for their faith. How would you like that for your mark as a true Christian? Or for me as a leader, they said, for leaders, if they don't go through the seminary or Bible training school called prison, then we're not sure about them yet. Throughout the books, wonderful books, at least the first one, the second one gets a little bit harder to read because of the suffering, but the first book, The Insanity of God, I highly recommend it. There's actually a documentary about the book, a film documentary that talks about the book. You might want to watch that. But throughout the book, Nick reveals the stories of many and how they suffer to help spread the gospel in some of the most difficult places in the world to reach with the gospel. Paul called this folly. God's folly. But is it really God who is foolish, or is it men and women who are the fools for not listening to and believing in the gospel of Jesus Christ? We'll talk about being a fool for Christ in a couple of weeks, in about a month. But let's look at 1 Corinthians for just a minute. We're going to start a series on 1 Corinthians today. We are starting one today, and we'll go for probably six months simply because of some holidays, special days, things like that. My plan is to do one main thought from each of the 16 chapters. That means I leave out an awful lot, okay? Just telling y'all ahead of time. But after reading through the book several times and praying through it, I feel like these are the key things that God was laying on my heart. So what is the book letter of 1 Corinthians? Well, it's a letter. Paul's writing to answer questions. That's why the title of the whole series for 1 Corinthians is Got Questions. Paul wrote this approximately 55 AD, so only about 20, 25 years after Christ was killed on the cross. Corinth was the heart of a major trade route from north to south. In Greece as well, by land, and from east to west by water. They would cross the land. They would take these small ships and roll them on wooden wheel-type carts across a four-mile stretch of land. Corinth was located on what's called an isthmus, I can't even say that very well, which is a narrow passage land between two bodies of water. And as I said, this was 4 miles wide, and it was about 10 miles long from north to south. Corinth was a really big city for those days. It had about 500,000 people, best archaeologists and scholars can estimate. And it has been called the Vanity Fair of the ancient world. Does anybody remember Vanity Fair? Right? Vanity Fair of the ancient world. Why? Well, the city was the site of the great temple of Aphrodite. Aphrodite, if you don't recall your Greek mythology, was the goddess of love. So there was a lot of loving going on in this city, at least they thought so. The name of the city was used as a synonym for wild living. In Greek, it's funny, it actually is Corinthianized. Almost exactly in the Greek. And to Corinthianize was to live like a Corinthian, or to live with drunken and immoral debauchery. This also was the location of the Isthmian Games, which were second only to the Olympic Games back in the day, the ancient day. William Barclay says, in this hotbed of vice, in the most unlikely place in all the Greek world, some of Paul's greatest work was done and some of the mightiest triumphs of Christianity were won. That is why Paul's correction on his teaching and how to live found in this book is so important for that day and for our age, as we are living in what could be called, as one scholar called it, a Neo-Corinthian age. Our age in these United States and in much of the Western world is a whole lot like what was going on in Corinth in those days. So again, why call this series on 1 Corinthians Got Questions? Because Paul uses a phrase, now concerning. By the way, I hope you'll take some time to read ahead and read these chapters and read the letter and think through it and pray through it. But Paul uses this phrase or similar types of phrases to introduce an idea. Now concerning was the main one that he used several times in chapter 7, twice, chapter 8, chapter 11, twice, chapter 12, 15, 16. He uses another phrase, it has been reported a few times, in order to answer some concerns. The first four chapters are kind of a hodgepodge of things talking about the apparent folly of God and the divisions in the church. Chapters 5 through 7 talk about sexuality, purity, marriage in the Las Vegas of the ancient Greek world. Chapters 8 through 10 talk about idolatry and Christian freedom. 11 through 14, worship and spiritual gifts. 15, the resurrection, the greatest chapter of the entire Bible on resurrection, explaining what resurrection is and will be for us as we die and rise again, or as Christ comes back and we rise to be with him. And finally, he closes, now concerning the offering for the saints in Jerusalem. So this letter is very peculiar in that it's addressing the concerns and the questions of people in Corinth, which is great because we have many of those same questions. Sexuality, for example, what is acceptable and what is not? Paul makes it pretty clear as we get to that in several weeks. Idolatry, yeah, we don't have metal images that we worship, but we sure do spend a lot of time, money, and effort on various other aspects of life that become like idols to us. So Paul begins this letter with a greeting much like all of his letters. Hello, I'm an apostle. I greet you in the name of Jesus. You can compare that to many of his other letters. And then he goes on to give a prayer of thanksgiving for the Corinthians. Again, very similar to most of his letters. Then he has to diverge into a discussion on the problems of division in the church. Divisions in the church. I think you all have an understanding about that. And Paul makes it clear that it's not Apollos or Peter or Paul, me, he says, that died for you and rose again to give you forgiveness of sin, salvation, and eternal life. It was Jesus Christ alone. And therefore, Paul preaches Jesus and not himself or anything else. We'll get back to divisions in chapter 3, by the way. And then we get into this section that Joe read earlier today that really hits on the concept of what I'm focusing on today, God's folly or man's. If we walk through this passage, we see very clearly in chapter 1, verse 21, that Paul introduces this idea, in 20, has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? And he goes on in 21, for since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through folly, through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. And you can just go through this verse by verse, and you'll see the verses that I want to emphasize are verses 22 through 25. Jews demand signs. Greeks want wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. Now let me give you a little Greek lesson. How many of y'all know the word scandal? You've heard that. How about moron? You know that. Now you know two Greek words. The scandal, the stumbling block here, or scandal, causes people to fall, right? A stumbling block. Calls people, they cannot possibly make sense out of why God would do such a foolish thing as send God himself to die for us on a cross. That's not the way the Messiah was supposed to come, but that's the way the Messiah came. Humble, riding on a donkey, crucified a week after he was proclaimed king. God's folly became a stumbling block to the Jews and moronic to the Greeks. That's what that Greek word is, folly, from moron. We know, at least we think we know what a moron is like, right? Somebody who's foolish, making unwise decisions. And yet God uses what seems foolish or moronic to proclaim his gospel. In verse 23, it goes on to say, we preach Christ crucified, which is a stumbling block and a stumbling block and foolish to the Jews, to the Greeks. What are they looking for? So the Jews are looking for signs. Have you ever read the Gospel of John? Anybody? I sure hope everybody could say that. What does John do? Seven signs to show who Jesus is. I could record all kinds of things that he said and did, signs that he did, but I've recorded these seven major signs so that you may know that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. So we have the signs, but we also have the foolish things. Well, what are they looking for? The Greeks are looking for spectacular. The Jews are looking for the spectacular, the eloquent, and all the fancy things. I think of our world today. I don't watch a whole lot of TV. Don't have a lot of time to sit and watch TV. But when we do, we see advertisements for movies that are coming to theaters or other TV shows. Y'all see those things, right? They seem to get more and more outlandish. More and more spectacular. They've got to be more violent. They've got to be more sexual. They've got to be more, or excuse me, not more faster paced, but faster paced. They've got to be more of everything. Spectacular seems to be what attracts people's attentions. I mean, think about it. Some of the tame shows have to be a little bit dangerous and extra exciting. For example, America's Ninja Warrior. How many of y'all like to watch that? I do. We don't watch it long, but I like to watch one or two, see if they'll make it or see if they fall. Right? Isn't that the fun part of it? They can't make it all the way. Or how about some of these let's get famous quick shows like America's Got Talent or The Voice or American Idol or these funny shows, Masked Singer, Dancer. They come up with these crazier and crazier shows just to try to get attention when if they would just write a decent show, it might actually attract some attention. Fancy that. Just like the Greeks in that day, we expect the outrageous or the spectacular. We've got to have the latest and greatest, the most bizarre, violent, sexual, or else it's not good enough to watch on TV or in the movies. And in verse 24, it goes on to say, while the Jews look for signs and the Greeks want the best philosophical wisdom of the age, Christians seek God's power. God's power and his wisdom. If you remember in Romans, Paul says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel. It's not that foolish or scandalous for me, but it is the power of God for salvation, first for the Jew, and then to us, the Gentiles, the nations. It's all folly, or moronic, or scandal. But God uses it time and time again to make his point. And we need to preach the gospel boldly, or proclaim the gospel boldly. As I was reading through this and thinking of this, I thought of a song that came out by a group named Truth. Anybody remember a group named Truth? Back in the 80s and into the 90s, maybe late 70s. I don't know when exactly they started. Probably late 70s into the early 90s. Trio came out with a song, Living Life Upside Down, right about the time our daughter Kira was born. Listen to some of the lyrics. Sounds like we're looking for the outlandish and spectacular, something crazy. John has a new way of looking at life. He's tired of his job, his kids, and his wife. He says the secret to his success was in leaving and finding himself. Now he's somebody to somebody else. You say you've risen to a new age of truth and you're calling it a spiritual godly pursuit, but I say, what if we've fallen to the bottom of a well thinking we've risen to the top of a mountain? What if we're knocking on the gates of hell thinking we're heaven bound? What if we spend our lives thinking of ourselves when we should be thinking of each other? What if we reach up and touch the ground to find we're living life upside down? With Texas's new law, this one is appropriate. We've got a program for saving the earth while unborn children are denied the right to birth. One baby's blessed, another's cursed. Have we made this world better or worse? Now the life of a tree comes first. You say we've risen to a new age of light. You're telling me what used to be wrong is now right. But I say, what if we're living life upside down? God's way does seem foolish. Because we're humans, we can't put it in a box to make sense out of it. How does a God who could create everything somehow empty himself, Philippians 2, empty himself to take on the form of man and live a perfect life, to die on a cross, to forgive all of our sins? Doesn't make sense in my brain. What's the alternative of a God that does that kind of thing, that loves that way? I was talking with one of my friends within the last year or so, and I had given him a couple of books. I gave him a book by Josh McDowell called More Than a Carpenter. Some of y'all might remember that old book. It was a simple, easy book to read. Not a big reader, so he took it. After he read it and looked a little bit from The Case for Christ, he came back to me one day and he said, Frank, I hope that this won't cause a problem between us as friends. I hope you won't ignore me because I just can't believe this. I said, that's fine. It won't bother our friendship one bit. I said, tell me what you can't believe. And he went on to say all of the foolish and moronic things that we proclaim as the gospel. And I said, well, you tell me what's more foolish or hard to believe. That there was nothing at all, and all of a sudden, somehow, it all came to be just by itself. And then out of the chaos of this mess, order happened. And then out of the chaos, the random pieces of order, somehow, life happened. And you're telling me that's easier to believe than that there's a God, or at least an intelligent design out there that somehow decided to make order and make things happen? He didn't have anything to say. You tell me what's more foolish. Scientists have terms for that. Order goes to chaos, not the other way around. And yet, so many people believe in the Big Bang theory or some version thereof. Whose foolishness is it? God's or man's? Is it really that hard to believe that the God of the universe might just love us enough, as he is written in John 3:16, that he would send his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our forgiveness, salvation, and eternal life? The bottom line in this passage is that Paul is going to preach Jesus and him crucified. We'll explain that further next week in chapter 2, verse 2. You can see that. And that whomever God has called will hear and accept this apparently foolish gospel. But to the rest, it will be a scandal and moronic, because they just can't get beyond their own self and their own brain. No matter. Paul will keep preaching it, because it is the power of God unto salvation, first for the Jew and then to all of us. Therefore, you and I also must keep proclaiming what seems crazy and will be rejected by many. We must proclaim Jesus. That's all that matters. His story, his gospel, his impact on your life. That's how we're going to reach this community with the gospel. That's how we're going to reach the world with the gospel. Yes, doing wonderful things like we did for Alan in Shelby for the week that we were there, or for the church that we worked with, Lily Memorial, or the other places that we work here around town, building ramps and such not. Those are great, but we must proclaim the gospel as well while we do it. His story, his gospel, his impact on your life. You join me? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your love. Thank you for calling us to yourself, so that even when we can't fully understand what it is that you did through Jesus Christ and how it works in our lives, we believe it. We believe it. For faith is believing in things that we do not see. So God, I pray that you'd help each one of us to stand firm on the gospel of Jesus Christ and to proclaim his story and ours to those who are dying around us and going to hell. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What a great song for us to conclude with today. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. You're invited to stand, to sing with us if you would like to pray or speak with me. I open the opportunity up to you. This is also a good time to think and pray as we prepare for communion. It's a time to reflect, confess sins, and come clean to the Last Supper as we partake of it. Let's sing.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him.
At this time, we'll enter into one of the two ordinances that we as Baptists celebrate or enjoy. And baptism coming up next week, that's the other, what we call ordinance. We have one. If you want to talk to me about your faith and desire to be baptized, we'll have the opportunity to add you to the waters as well next week if you want. So that's an opportunity. But today we will have communion. So I call the deacons forward as we get started today. So what is the purpose of communion? It is to commemorate the death of Christ. This do in remembrance of me. It is to signify, seal, and apply to believers all the benefits of the new covenant. In this ordinance, Christ ratifies his promises to his people, and they on their part solemnly consecrate themselves to him and to enter into his entire service. Communion is a badge of the Christian profession. It indicates and promotes the communion of believers with Christ. It represents the mutual communion of believers with one another. The elements used represent Christ's body and blood. They are bread and wine. The fruit of the vine or the grape juice is used for his blood and the wafer for his body. This is a permanent ordinance in the Church of Christ and is to be observed until he comes again. Who can participate in communion? There are two beliefs among churches. The first one is closed communion, where only members of church can partake of the Lord's Supper. We believe in open communion, where everyone attending today who has placed their faith in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior may participate in the Lord's Supper. We began a study of 1 Corinthians this morning from chapter 1. Paul talks about the Lord's Supper in chapter 11. He ends by saying, "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Note that word, examine yourself. "For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died." This is Paul's writing to the Corinthians. Let me pray. Father in heaven, as we come together, I pray your blessings on this time. Help us to look inwardly. Show us, Lord, what is displeasing in your sight, where we have missed the mark of what honors and glorifies you. Help us to remember what Christ did on our behalf through his cruel crucifixion and death, and the promise of resurrection that we have as well through his wonderful resurrection from the grave on the third day. We give you praise as we partake of this. In your name we pray. Amen. As he ushers you, come forward, come down the middle, and go around the outside. Thank you. finishing up. I'll give you one more chance. Has anybody missed getting? Tim, would you serve Faye right here? Anybody else in the congregation missed? I hope Joe and Josh got everybody outside. Okay. Let's come. So if you're working with this, maybe you got a jump start, but please peel carefully just the top part off the wafer so you don't spill the juice. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 24, Paul writes this: "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Mark, will you lead us in a quick word of prayer?
Let us pray. Lord, as we take this symbol of your broken body, we ask for your blessing on it, for we know that we are made whole because of your sacrifice on the cross. Amen.
Amen. Continuing in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25, Paul continues: "In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Mark, would you please pray?
Lord, please bless us as we partake of this symbol of your blood, which was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Amen.
Amen. Please partake.
Thank you. You may be seated.
I'm going to ask, as our benediction, Shelly, can you play "In Christ Alone"? Can you bring up "In Christ Alone"? The third verse after, I think it's the third, maybe the fourth verse, go down to where he is risen from the grave. Okay? Just click through them and I'll help you stop. Stand, let's stand and sing this. This will be our benediction. Keep going. Keep going. We gotta bury him. One more, keep going. Back up. One more, back up. That's it, isn't it? Is this it? And
They're in the ground, sorry.
Okay, my bad. There you go. Let's sing this in celebration. God bless you. This is the last week of our missionaries in residence. I've asked George and Faye Kennedy to stand at the back. Y'all greet them on your way out. Okay? Thank you, and God bless.